The life and thought of Howard Washington Thurman, a son of Issachar, Randolph Bracey Jr. Dean, Cornelius and Dorothy Henderson School of Religion, Bethune-Cookman University, Spring 2019. Howard Washington Thurman, a son of Issachar. The question arises, who was Howard Thurman? Howard Washington Thurman was an influential American author, philosopher, theologian, educator, preacher, and pastor. He was born in West Palm Beach, Florida on November 18, 1899. He died April 10, 1981 in San Francisco, California. He was the son of Saul Solomon, a railroad worker, and Alice Ambrose Thurman. He married Kate Kelly, a social worker, in 1926, and she died in 1930. He married Sue Bailey, a writer and social historian, in 1932. Who was Howard Thurman? Howard Thurman was a son of Issachar. And of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times, to know what Israel ought to do, the heads of them were 200, and all their brethren were at their commandment. 1 Chronicles 12:32. For the first 7 years of his reign, David was king over one tribe, Judah. But after the death of Ishbosheth, King Saul's son, the mighty men from all the tribes came to Hebron, determined to make him king over all Israel. 1 Chronicles 12 lists the tribes which came to David. Of special note is verse 32, which lifts the tribe of Issachar by setting them apart from the others, describing them as men who understood the times and knew what Israel should do. Understanding of the times and knowing what to do suggests that these men were from the tribe of Issachar, were very intelligent men, who were well-versed in social affairs, and who knew what was proper to be done in the pressure situations of life. In short, the men of Issachar had a deep understanding and a strong discernment of what was going on around them. They were the men who were able to interpret the Word of God by recognizing the significance of past events and applying the lessons learned to the present and future. Like the men of Issachar, Howard Washington Thurman was such a person. He was aware of the cultural changes that were happening around him in his day and time, and was blessed with a message to meet those challenges in reaching an ever-changing society, both at home and abroad. His early years were spent in the community of Waycross, where he was a member of the Mount Bethel Baptist Church, and at an early age, he was baptized in the Halifax River. The Daytona of Thurman's early years was a Jim Crow town in the Deep South, with the schools separate and unequal. Thurman's boyhood in Daytona taught him many lessons. The obvious was the meaning of growing up poor and black in a profoundly unequal and segregated society. In this regard, Daytona was most unusual in that it was one of the handful of communities across the state of Florida where blacks participated in the political and civic society on their own terms. Primarily, this was due to the fact that significant numbers of northern wealthy whites made Daytona their place of retreat during the winter months. Most notable was John D. Rockefeller, the richest man in America from New York, and James Gamble, the soap manufacturer of Procter & Gamble of Ohio.
I've been the dreamer, but oh, how wonderfully you have interpreted my dream.
During those growing up years, Thurman had African-American role models, both male and female, but none had a more profound impact on him than Mary McLeod Bethune, founder of the Daytona Educational and Industrial Training School for Girls. In 1904, Mayor McLeod Bethune founded the school under the most humble and trying of circumstances, daily scavenging the community for orange box crates, for desks and stools for our students, and anything else she could find, along with the selling of sweet potato pies to finance the effort. Bethune started the school with the dream of creating a center of quality education for Negro women in the South. Thurman would develop a lifelong friendship with Dr. Bethune. Howard Thurman spent most of his childhood in this late 19th century two-story wood frame vernacular residence. At the time, Daytona Beach was a rigidly segregated environment. At night, African Americans could not cross the Halifax River into the white section of town without special permission. Constructed in 1899, the house is on the National Register of Historic Places and the Florida Black Heritage Trail. Upon his graduation from the eighth grade, Thurman was accepted at the Florida Baptist Academy in Jacksonville, 100 miles to the north. It was one of only three high schools for African Americans in the state of Florida. After leaving Daytona for Jacksonville to pursue his education, Thurman would never again live in Daytona for an extended period of time, but it was a place where he would periodically return throughout his career, often at the request of his friend, Mary McLeod Bethune's invitation to speak at her college. Thurman proved to be a brilliant student at the Florida Baptist Academy, earning grades in the high 90s with a rigorous curriculum, including 3 years of Latin and 1 year of Greek. In 1918, Thurman's senior year, Florida Baptist Academy moved to a 114-acre former plantation property in St. Augustine, Florida, and changed its name to Florida Normal and Industrial Institute. This institution would become the harbinger and forerunner of the Florida Memorial University in Miami today. Outside his formal instruction in high school and college, no institution was more important to Howard Thurman in his formative years than the Young Men's Christian Association, the YMCA. Black students participated in the YMCA events, with the most celebrated being the Kings Mountain Student Conference in North Carolina. Thurman attended his first Kings Mountain retreat in the summer of 1917 as a high school sophomore. At the retreat, Thurman would meet one person who would have one of the greatest impacts upon his life, Mordecai Wyatt Johnson. In 1917, Johnson was the minister of the First Baptist Church of Charleston, West Virginia, and was developing a national reputation as one of Black America's most brilliant orators and religious leaders. In 1918, Thurman begged Johnson for his mentorship. He wrote, "I want to be a minister of the gospel. I feel the needs of my people. I see their distressing condition and have offered myself upon the altar as a living sacrifice, in order that I may help the skinned and flung down, as you interpret. God wants me, and his precious love urges me to take up the cross and follow him." Following in the footsteps of his hero, Mordecai Johnson, who had graduated earlier in 1911 with a Bachelor of Arts degree, Thurman entered Morehouse College of Atlanta, Georgia. At Morehouse, a number of faculty put their imprint on Thurman, beginning with John Hope, the first African-American president of Morehouse. Benjamin Elijah Mays, a faculty member who awoke in Thurman an interest in philosophy and was Thurman's debating coach. E. Franklin Frazier, the renowned sociologist and avowed atheist, challenged Thurman to think critically about his faith. In 1923, Thurman finished Morehouse as valedictorian of his class. He was offered an instructorship in economics with a chance to validate his degree at the University of Chicago. Instead, Thurman chose to attend Rochester Theological Seminary, now known as Colgate-Rochester-Crozer Divinity School, Rochester, New York. Again, following the path of his hero, Mordecai Johnson, who had graduated earlier from the institution, it was at Rochester Theological Seminary that Howard Thurman came of age. Thurman entered Rochester Theological Seminary in the fall of 1923. It was a seminary known for its modernistic liberalism, academic rigor, and commitment to the social gospel. It was an institution that placed major emphasis on the production of scholar, preacher, slash pastors for the parish ministry. By the time Thurman arrived at Rochester Theological Seminary, the institution's most famous faculty member, Walter Rauschenbusch, founder of the social gospel movement, had died, but had left an indelible imprint on the school for decades to come. In short, the social gospel movement concentrated on the widening gap between rich and poor and speaking out against the structures that legitimized those institutions. Thurman graduated from the Rochester Seminary in 1925 and was ordained a Baptist minister. From 1926 to 1928, Howard Thurman served as pastor of the Mount Zion Baptist Church of Oberlin, Ohio. From 1928 to 1931, as teacher and dean of the chapel at Morehouse College, Atlanta. From 1929 to 1931, as professor of religion and religious advisor to Spelman College. Thurman pursued study at Haverford College with noted Quaker mystic Rufus Jones, who also had a hand in shaping Thurman's theology. On June 26, 1926, at the age of 36, Mordecai Wyatt Johnson was unanimously elected the 11th president of Howard University, becoming the first African-American to serve as head of that institution. Prior to coming to Howard University as president, Johnson served as professor of economics at Morehouse College. During his 34-year tenure as president from 1926 to 1960, Mordecai Johnson put together the finest assemblage of black academic talent this country has ever seen. Charles Hamilton Houston, dean of the law school and mentor to Thurgood Marshall and his assault upon separate but equal in public schools. Elaine Leroy Locke, chairman of the Department of Philosophy and the first African American to win the Rhodes Scholarship. Ralph Bunche, chairman of the Political Science Department and Nobel Peace Prize winner for his mediation in Palestine. Charles Drew of the Medical School for his work in perfecting blood plasma. E. Franklin Frazier, renowned sociologist and author of Black Bourgeoisie. Sterling Brown, professor and chairman of the English department and noted Harlem Renaissance poet. Benjamin Elijah Mays, dean of the School of Religion and his longtime protege, Howard Washington Thurman, as dean of Andrew Rankin Chapel. Howard Washington Thurman, a son of Issachar, from 1932 to 1943, Thurman served as professor of religion and dean of Rankin Chapel from 1935 to 43. Ebony Magazine recognized Thurman as one of the 50 most important figures in African-American history. In 1953, Life Magazine selected Howard Thurman as one of the 12 greatest religious leaders of his time. In 1935, the National YMCA and YWCA International Committee invited Howard Thurman to lead a delegation of African Americans on a pilgrimage to Burma, Ceylon, and India, where they would prepare the student Christian movement. In India, Howard Thurman met Mohandas Gandhi. Mohandas Gandhi's advice to Howard Washington Thurman, a son of Issachar: be the change you wish to see. Over his life, Howard Thurman would write more than 20 books, with his most famous being Jesus and the Disinherited in 1944. For this class, three major books will be our source: With Head and Heart, an autobiography of Howard Thurman; Jesus and the Disinherited by Howard Thurman, a strange free sermon on religious experience and public life. Howard Thurman was an early influence on Martin Luther King Jr. when he became Dean of Marsh Chapel at Boston University. Thurman had known the young King through his father, Martin Luther King Sr., who was Thurman's classmate at Morehouse. Thurman's time with the young King at Boston University overlapped for a year, and it is reported that King carried a dog-eared copy of Jesus and the Disinherited book while leading the 1955-56 Montgomery bus boycott. Walter Fluker, one of the premier students of Thurman's writings, stated, "I don't believe you get a Martin Luther King Jr. without a Howard Thurman." It was the poet Rudyard Kipling in his immortal poem, If, who wrote the lines, "If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings, not lose the common touch." Here is a picture of Howard Thurman with First Lady of the United States Eleanor Roosevelt and Coleman Jennings in 1944 at a testimonial dinner given for Dean Howard Thurman at his leaving Howard University to establish the Fellowship Church in San Francisco, California. Thurman served the Church for the Fellowship of All Peoples from 1944 to 1953, now a historic landmark in San Francisco.
To fulfill the highest, most truthful expression of yourself as a human being. You want to max out your humanity by using your energy to lift yourself up, your family, and the people around you. Theologian Howard Thurman said it best. He said, "Don't ask yourself what the world needs. Ask yourself what makes you come alive, and then go do that. Because what the world needs is people who have come alive."
Many feel it is Howard Thurman, through his insights and early commitment to nonviolence, who evokes a spirit felt across the entire movement.
Whether we want it that way or not, we are all tied together. Every Negro in America is a little white, and every white man in America is a little Negro. The Negro needs the white man to save him from his fears, and the white man needs the Negro to save him from his guilt. We need each other.
People sometimes seem to think that nonviolence was very endemic to the African-American community as a way of life, when in fact it was not. And even Thurman is very clear that nonviolence was a kind of a cultivated experience for most rank-and-file people, including leadership.
I would agree that Howard Thurman was a saint of the movement.
He gave us the basis for the march, that we know why we march, the principles upon which we march, how we march, and what we do after the march.
He helped to establish the philosophical framework for of how to struggle. You cannot let the oppressor break your spirit, then make him break your bones or your arms, but not your spirit. That's the stuff of Howard Thurman.
Dr. King was not completely committed to nonviolence. When I say not committed, he saw it first as a tactic until he was fully converted to it as a lifestyle. And my father helped me with that, to understand that early on, people saw things as a tactic. This is the best way. Dr. King then moves to, this is a lifestyle. And that is a direct connection to Thurman's conversion. And here is a nonviolent revolutionary.
One of the foundational works for the movement is a book by Thurman, Jesus and the Disinherited.
I have been told that Dr. King carried Jesus and the Disinherited with him most of the time when he traveled.
It's a book that really describes what it means to be involved in such a struggle as a spiritual matter, as a matter of faith, and not just the effort to change laws for the gaining of civil rights.
He says that the African Americans didn't have any rights, just like Jesus, but they could choose to ground themselves in their own inherent dignity and worth. And if one were to choose this, it would have a lot to do with how they would deal with the question of what do you do when your back is against the wall.
Howard Washington Thurman, a son of Issachar. In closing, it is time to connect the dots. Our text, from the beginning, it says, and of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the time, to know what Israel ought to do. The heads of them were 200, and all their brethren were at their commandment. 1 Chronicles 12, verse 32, King James Version. At the beginning of this lecture, I took poetic license by putting Howard Washington Thurman into the Old Testament tribe of Issachar, for I believe that Thurman was a rare individual who understood the times and knew what to do. From humble beginnings here in Daytona Beach, Thurman rose to international acclaim as one of the greatest theological minds of the 20th century. He was a pastor, he was a preacher, philosopher, poet, scholar, mystic, all wrapped up into one. Howard Thurman, a son of Issachar, understood the times and knew what to do, died April 10th, 1981. Howard Washington Thurman, a son of Issachar. One final footnote. Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune, President Emeritus of Bethune-Cookman College, insisted that Howard Thurman be the eulogist at her funeral. In 1955, Howard Washington Thurman delivered Dr. Bethune's eulogy entitled Shafts of Light. She is buried on this campus. Three pictures from that day. The first one, Thurman preaching Bethune's eulogy at the Hine Memorial Chapel. The second is Thurman in the line of march to the burial plot. He is behind the gentleman with the white suit. And finally, at home with Mrs. Bethune at her place, the Thurmans, Howard and Sue Bailey Thurman.